I'm going to talk about a theorem of Aleksandrov. This is something which is accessible to students who know something about real analysis and metric spaces and so on. I'll define all that is needed. I'll start with general definitions, but don't worry too much about it. It will, you know, we'll stick to a very special case of of Aleksandrov's theorem. Namely, we will look at the open interval 0,1 in the real line, and we will sort of try to understand Aleksandrov's theorem for that space, open interval 0,1. The theorem works in general. I'll indicate what it is at the end. Okay, so it is aimed at students who have finished BSc. So you know, so others might find it a bit too elementary. But this is a theorem which is not generally done in a classroom. So I hope some of you will find it interesting. So I'll start with definitions and so on. Okay, so we start with metric spaces. As I said, even though the definition will be general, we will concentrate on very concrete spaces. Okay, so XBS set. A metric. So by a metric, we mean a distance function. So it tells you the distance between points. So a metric on X is a function from X cross X. It's a non-negative function. So for each pair of points XY, you have D of XY. D is the distance function. So D of XY is greater than or equal to zero. Of course, the distance between two points should be positive or zero, right? And it is zero if and only if the points are same. So that's a very natural definition. And distance between X and Y should be same as distance between Y and X, right? Two points should have the same distance. Whether you go from A to B or B to A, you should have the same distance. Third one is important. It's the triangle inequality. This is something you already know. If you have a triangle, then the length of one side is less than or equal to sum of the length of the other two sides, right? So if you take three points, X, Y, and Z, picture or imagine a triangle with vertices X, Y, Z, then DXY, that is the distance between X and Y, so that is the length of the side with vertices X and Y, that is less than or equal to DXZ plus DZY for any X, Y, Z in capital X, right? So this is the triangle inequality. So all these are very natural definitions you come up from looking at the distances you already know, like the real line or the plane and so on. Okay, so this is a principle in mathematics. You have certain concrete spaces, quantities, and then you see certain common properties, and you make them into a definition and study those objects, right? That is how the subject develops. Okay, so this is what you mean by a metric space. So we'll look at examples, and simple examples, nothing too complicated. There are very interesting examples of metric spaces, which is out of the scope for this lecture, but it's an important class of objects one studies. So let's look at examples. So first one is what you are familiar with, that is X is the real line. So you take the real line as your space. The distance is the usual distance, right? If I take two points X and Y on the real line, the length of the interval XY is mod of X minus Y, right? So that's precisely the distance between X and Y. So that is the basic example you can always keep in mind. Every other property is sort of very similar to what you can do with the modulus function. Okay, well, you can modify this mod X minus Y slightly by multiplying this with a positive number alpha. Okay, so DXY you can define to be alpha times mod X minus Y, where alpha is positive. Okay, even that is a, so that is like distorting the distance, right? So distance between the points 1 and 2 is 1 in the standard case. You can distort it to half or 3 or whatever, and then accordingly distort everything else, right? So that will give you another distance function. So you can always change the distance functions. The next one is interesting, that is the minimum of mod x minus y comma 1. This is how you make a metric sort of bounded. So if you go to the first example, mod of x minus y is not bounded in the sense, you know, for example, if you take y to be 0, then the distance between 0 and x is mod x, and as x goes to infinity, it becomes infinity. But in the third example, it is minimum of mod x minus y and 1. So once the mod x minus y is greater than or equal to 1, distance is always 1. So far away points are at a distance 1. That is what it means. Okay, we'll come to this kind of examples later on. There is a relation between the example in 3 and example in 1. You know, they give you same set of convergent sequences. So, you know, so the collection of open sets, closed sets, etc. on the real line will not change with this metric. So in sophisticated language, it means it gives you the same topology. So if you haven't seen what a topology is, don't worry about it. I'm not going to use any topological notions, but for the sake of people who understand what it is, I'll keep saying what you know, certain terms. Okay, so there may be terms which you may not understand, but don't worry too much about it. Fourth example is the discrete metric. This is a very simple example. Any two points are at a distance 1. Okay, and it's easy. So in all these examples, you have to check that this defines a metric by checking those three conditions. But those are all, you know, straightforward exercises, so I'll not spend time on it. The discrete metric is something which you can put on any set. Given any set, you can define this. Okay, so any set can be made into a metric space, but it's not always very interesting, and most of the time this is used to construct counter examples. Okay, so fourth one, I'll leave it as an exercise to you. Prove that dxy equal to modulus of x minus y divided by 1 plus mod x minus y. That is also a metric. Okay, so you have to check various things. First is dxy is greater than or equal to 0. That is trivial. Dxy is 0 if and only if x equal to y. That is also trivial. And dxy is equal to dyx. That's also trivial. So the only non-trivial part to check is the triangle inequality. So that you can prove it using the fact that the function t by 1 plus t is increasing. Okay, that is, it's enough to use that. So I'll leave it to you to check this. Again, you need to sort of realize, I'll comment upon this later on, that the standard metric, which is mod x minus y, and this metric mod x minus y by 1 plus mod x minus y will give you same set of convergent sequences. In other words, if xn converges to x in modulus function, xn converges to x, if and only if xn converges to x in this d, which is mod by 1 plus mod. Well, you can also generalize. If I have a metric space x and a metric d, then you can define a new metric using d by 1 plus d. That is what we are doing, right? Mod x minus y by 1 plus mod x minus y. Instead of that, you look at d and d by 1 plus d, you will get a new metric. And it will have essentially the same properties. Okay, so again, the takeaway from this slide is that there are examples, and you can redefine the space. Okay, with what is known as an equivalent metric. I'll come to that a little bit more in the next few slides. So if there are questions, please interrupt and ask. Okay, since I'm in full screen, I won't be able to see anything in the chat box or anything. So please feel free to interrupt and ask questions. Okay, so let us start with a very simple question. Let X be any set, and I give you a function f from X to R. Can you define a metric on X using this function f from X to R? Well, we'll come to the answer in the next slide, but there is a mathematical principle behind this which I want you to understand. If you look at the right hand side, that is the real line. The real line has a metric already, right? I want you to use that metric to define a metric on x and using this function f. So this is a basic principle in mathematics called pullback. So you pull back something, some structure from some space to a new space you are interested in using a function. Okay, it can be a function or some other map. So think of f as relabeling x. So you take a point small x in x and you look at f of x. F of x will be a point in the real line. So you are sort of viewing capital X as a subset of the real line, and the real line already has a metric, right? That is a modulus. You can restrict that to the image of capital X, right? So that will give you a metric on the image of capital X, and image of capital X can be identified with X under some properties of F. Then you have a metric. Okay, so this is what is called a pullback. So you use the function to pull back whatever structure you have on the right hand side to the space on the left hand side. Okay, so let us see the answer. So if I have a function, you can define. So, well, if f is 1, 1, you can define this. So let's forget about the 1, 1-ness. Let's go to the definition. Define d of xy equal to modulus of f of x minus f of y. So this is what I meant by pull back the metric. So you identify two points x and y to be f of x and f of y in the real line, and you use the metric there and define that to be the metric on your capital X. Well, of course you have to prove that it's a metric. So let's look at the definition. First is dxy is greater than or equal to 0. Of course it's modulus of something, so that is greater than or equal to 0. There is no problem. Dxy is 0 if and only if x equal to 1. So if dxy is 0, you have f of x minus f of y is 0. So that is f of x equal to f of y. But that does not imply x equal to y unless f is 1, 1. So that is why we have this condition f is 1, 1. So if f is 1, 1, dxy equal to 0 will imply f of x equal to f of y. That will imply x equal to 1. Okay. And triangle inequality is trivial. Okay, that is the triangle inequality of the modulus function. So dxy you want to prove that is less than or equal to dxz plus dzy. And you write f of x minus f of y, bring in f of z in between. Just like how will you prove triangle inequality for the modulus function. Okay. So if you look at this proof, you can write it down. This is a very simple exercise. If you look at this proof, the 1-1-ness of f was used only at one place. That was proving that dxy 0 implies x equal to y, right? That is the only place where 1-1-ness was used. So whenever you have a 1-1 function, you can pull back the metric. Now, let's go to the next line. So if d is a, if you already have a metric d on capital X and f is any function, need not be 1, 1, I can define a new metric d1 of xy equal to dxy plus modulus of f of x minus f of y. Now this will be a genuine metric on capital X. Well, why is that? Again, we can check these three conditions. Look at d1 xy greater than or equal to 0, that is true because you are adding two non-negative things, so there is no problem. d1 xy equal to 0 if and only if x equal to y. Well, that is true because if d1 xy is 0, then both dxy and modulus of f of x minus f of y both will have to be 0. But if dxy is 0, then x equal to y, because d is already a metric. So if I know that I have a metric d, adding something like mod fx minus fy will not, I mean, it will give you a new metric. You don't have to have f to be a 1-1 function. Okay, so it is, you can add anything like this to a metric and still get a metric. Of course, the metric changes, the distance changes, convergence sequences can change. Okay, so the space x with the new metric d1 can be quite different from the metric space X with the metric D. Okay, so you need to keep in mind that. But this is something we are going to use very crucially soon. Okay, so let us continue. So we have seen examples of metric spaces. We have seen that if I have a function f, real valued function, then I can pull back the metric if f is 1, 1, and if I already have a metric, I can add something like modulus of f of x minus f of y, and you get a different metric. Okay, so there are different ways of putting metrics on a given space. Okay, all right. Now some definitions. So this is something you have seen on the real line. So just like we saw the definition of the metric as a generalization of properties of the modulus function, we will generalize the concepts you have seen on the real line. Okay, so let X D be a metric space. So D is a distance function on X. A sequence xn in X is said to converge to X in X if the distance between xn and X goes to zero, right? So this is what you do in the case of real line. If I have a sequence xn in the real line, xn converging to X means, well, there is epsilon, delta and all that. I'll not go get into that. You simply look at modulus of xn minus X, that has to go to zero, right? That is same as saying xn converging to X. So the modulus we replace by the distance, right? So that gives us a definition of convergent sequence on a metric space X. So D of xn comma X goes to zero as n goes to infinity. That is what you mean by a convergent sequence. Xn converging to X implies means D of xn X goes to zero. And of course, as in the real line, you can prove that the limit is unique and things like that. Okay, so people who have seen metric spaces would realize that all those proofs are exactly like the proofs for the modulus function. Okay, you don't need any extra ideas or concepts. All you need is triangle inequality and things like that. Okay, so now we lift the definition of Cauchy sequence from the real line to a metric space. So xn is said to be Cauchy if, this is the technical part, for every epsilon there exists a capital N depending on epsilon such that the distance between xn and xm is less than epsilon for every N and M greater than capital N, right? So as capital N increases or N and M increases, the distance between the terms in the sequence should become smaller and smaller and smaller. Okay, that is a rough idea. The points in the sequence come closer and closer. Okay, that is what you mean by a Cauchy sequence. So this is again a definition lifted from the real line with a modulus, right? There you will have modulus of xn minus xm less than epsilon. And a metric space xd is said to be complete if every Cauchy sequence in X converges, okay, in X. So you can't go out of X, so you have to have a limit inside X. So you take any Cauchy sequence in X, xn, let us say, then there is an X in capital X to which it will converge. And of course, the limit is unique, etc. We have already seen. So such a space is called a complete metric space. Now you need to notice that the convergence depends on the distance, right? Because you want the distance to go to zero. So if I change the metric, the convergence sequences can change. So you may have several metrics on a given space X. Some metric might be complete, some metric may not be complete. Okay? The convergence sequences can change depending on the metric D. Okay, so this is something you should keep in mind, because we are going to look at completeness as the property which we want. It's a desirable property to have. You will see that when you study more mathematics. And we are trying to impose or construct new metric so that the space is complete. Okay, so are there any questions? Okay, so I'll go ahead. If there are questions, please feel free to interrupt. Okay, so yeah, so let us look at examples. Complete metric space. So the real line with the metric modulus of x minus y, that's a complete metric space. This is something which you have seen in real analysis. So completeness is equivalent to the axioms you have seen, that is the least upper bound property or the greatest lower bound property, right? LUB and GLB. So on the real line, you have that property. So if you have those properties, then you can prove completeness easily. Okay. So real line with the usual metric mod x minus y is complete. You can change the metric, as I said. You can take the minimum of mod x minus y comma 1, and that is also complete. Well, why is that? If I take a Cauchy sequence xn with respect to the metric minimum of mod x minus y comma 1, I know the terms come close, right? So xn minus xn will have modulus less than epsilon. So if epsilon is less than 1, that is going to be the usual mod xn minus xn, right? So that is like Cauchy in the usual modulus, and so it will converge. So this is the property I was talking about earlier. If you look at 1 and 2, the metrics are different, right? One is mod x minus y, the other is minimum of mod x minus y comma 1. The second metric is bounded, it's less than or equal to 1 always. The first metric is unbounded, right? It takes different values. But when you look at completeness property, both are complete. The convergent sequences are same. If xn converges to x in modulus, then mod of xn minus x goes to 0. But if mod of xn minus x goes to 0, it will become less than 1 after a while. So in the new metric, minimum of mod x minus y 1, it will be the same value, mod xn minus x, right? So it will converge in that metric as well. So you can change the metric, make the metric bounded, unbounded, etc., without changing the basic properties on the metric space X. Okay, so there are properties on the metric space like convergence sequences. Convergence defines closed sets define open sets, right? Looking at complement and so on. So on metric space, most of the properties are determined by what are the convergence sequences you have. Okay, so that is a point you should keep in mind, because we'll come back to that again and again. Now, X, if I take a set X and put the discrete metric, then that is obviously complete, because distance between any two points is 1. So if I take a Cauchy sequence Xn, the distance has to become smaller and smaller, right? So the moment it is less than 1, the only possibility is that the points are same, right? Otherwise, the distance is 1. It cannot be less than 1. So it will become eventually constant. So a Cauchy sequence in a discrete metric space would look like you will have x1, x2, x3, x4, and after a while it is just x, 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 x. Okay, there is nothing else. So such sequences always converge, right? So that is a easy example of a complete metric space. It's not very, very interesting. But as I said, it is used generally for producing counterexamples. Okay, so the fourth example is the space open interval 0, 1 with the usual metric mod x minus y, and that is not complete. Well, why is it not complete? So I should be able to produce a Cauchy sequence which does not converge in X. So remember, our space is capital X. Okay, we don't know anything about points outside capital X. So if you take the sequence 1 by n, I know that 1 by n is a Cauchy sequence with respect to the metric mod x minus y. And I know that 1 by n converges to 0 with respect to the metric mod x minus y, but in the real line, right? So it converges to 0, but 0 is not in my space X. Okay. So capital X equal to open interval 0, 1 is not a complete space. Okay. So our aim is to make such sets complete without changing the basic structure of the space. Okay, that is what is Alexandrov's theorem. Okay, so I hope you have understood completeness. So let's go to the let's look at some more examples. Consider the real line with the metric. So we have seen that if I have a metric, I can look at mod by 1 plus mod, right? So that's another metric. So dxy is modulus of x minus y by 1 plus mod x minus y. This is also a complete metric space. Well, let us see why. If I have xn to be Cauchy with respect to this new metric, then, well, you prove that it is Cauchy with respect to the old metric modulus. And convergence is same with respect to both the metric. Okay, so xn modulus of xn minus x goes to 0 if and only if d of xn comma x goes to 0. That is very easy to prove. Okay, so that's, I have written this in the bracket, an goes to 0 if and only if an by 1 plus an goes to 0. Okay, so that's an easy statement, and that will tell me that xn goes to x in modulus if and only if xn goes to x with respect to the metric d. And from that you can see that both are complete metric spaces. More importantly, convergent sequences in Rd and R comma modulus are same. So the space is same, capital R. I have two metrics, D and the modulus. They are different metrics, so the distances are different between points, but both are complete and both have same convergent sequences. So if xn goes to x with respect to the modulus, then xn converges to x with respect to the metric D. Now this tells me various things. Okay, so if convergent sequences are same, if you go back to the definition of open sets, closed sets and all that in the real line or Rn or in metric spaces, you will see that closed sets are going to be same. What do I mean by that? Well, what are closed sets? A set is closed if it contains all its limit points. What are limit points? Limit points roughly are those points which are very close to the set, right? Any neighborhood of the point should intersect your set. So if I keep shrinking the neighborhoods, I'm going to get a sequence from the set which will converge to that point, right? So in mathematical language, if I take a set A and if x is a limit point of A, then there is a sequence xn from A converging to x, right? But remember, the convergence depends on the metric. So a set which is closed in Rd may not be closed in R with respect to the modulus metric unless the convergence sequences are same. Okay, so what we have written here is that convergence sequences are same. So if I take a set A, subset of R, closed with respect to the metric D, then it is closed with respect to modulus and vice versa. So if all the closed sets are same, all the open sets are same, because open sets are simply complement of closed sets. So if closed sets are same, open sets are same. In sophisticated language, this means the topology of the space Rd and R comma modulus function are same. Even though the metrics are same, they have the same topology. Okay, so again, people who have learned topology would remember that completeness, etc., is not a topological property, right? You can have homeomorphic images which are complete and not complete and so on. Okay, so the takeaway from all this is that it is possible to define new metrics without changing the topology. So I am not going to define what a topology is. Think of it as collection of open sets. Okay, but on a metric space, it is enough to look at convergence sequences, because convergence sequences will tell you what are closed sets, and if closed sets are same, then the open sets are same, because open sets are complements of closed sets. So everything can be defined in terms of sequences. Okay, so now we go to the problem. So this is the starting of the Aleksandrov's theorem. So, but this is a extremely simple case. So can you put a metric on the open interval 0, 1 to make it complete? So we saw that open interval 0, 1 with the modulus is not complete. Question is, can you make it complete by putting a new metric? Of course, you can always put the discrete metric, right? This is not interesting. Discrete metric will make AD space complete, but that's not interesting because 0, 1 already has a metric. I don't want to lose that structure. Okay, so let us redefine the problem very precisely. Construct a metric D. So remember, metric is a distance function which has three properties, right? On 0, 1, such that 01 comma d is complete. So that means you take any Cauchy sequence in 01 with respect to the metric d, it has to converge to a point inside the open interval 01. Okay. Moreover, the property I want, so that is what I mean by I don't want to lose the existing structure. Okay. So 01 comma d and 01 comma the modulus metric have the same set of convergent sequences. That means if xn is a sequence in 01 and x is in 01, that is the important part. Remember, the point is inside 01, x. Then dxn x goes to 0, that means xn converges to x with respect to the metric d, if and only if xn minus x goes to 0. That means xn converges to x with respect to the modulus. So if we look at the space 01, you don't know any points outside 01, right? You know only points inside 01. Inside 01, the convergence sequences are same, whether it's with respect to d, the new metric you put, or with respect to the standard metric mod xn minus x. Okay. So in particular, if I take the sequence 1 by n, the 1 by n I know goes to 0 with respect to the modulus metric, but 0 is not in my space. Okay. So the 1 by n does not converge inside 01. So the 1 by n should not converge with respect to the metric d as well. Okay. So remember that. So I hope the question is clear. This is called remetrizing the space. Since the convergent sequences are same, the closed sets are same, the open sets are same, so the topology doesn't change. So open interval 01 with the modulus gives me a metric space. So it has a topology, it has collection of open sets, but it is not complete. Question is, can you put a metric D on 01? So that the topology is the same. So open sets are same, closed sets are same, convergent sequences are same, but it is complete. That means any Cauchy sequence with respect to the new metric D will converge to some point inside 01. Okay. So remember that part. So that is our aim. Okay. So that is Aleksandrov's theorem, that it can be done. It can be done for a lot of sets. So we'll see what sets. Okay, so I hope the question is clear. If there is any doubt, please feel free to interrupt. Okay, so let us look at the solution. So I'm going to give you the metric directly. Okay, so you look at d of x, y on 0, 1 equal to mod x minus y. So that is the standard metric plus something. Now, what are these something? First term is 1 by x minus 1 by y. Plus 1 by 1 minus x minus 1 by 1 minus 1. Okay, so we'll see the proof. Okay, so forget the proof for the time being. Why does one define something like this? So mod x minus y is the standard metric. So I don't want to lose that. So let us keep that. Now you can remember the first few slides where we defined metric using a function and so on. So mod of f of x minus f y. So if I have a metric, adding a quantity like mod of fx minus fy will give me another metric, right? So think of this one by x is a function, right? X going to 1 by x is a function. So that term is like modulus of fx minus fy. The other term is like modulus of gx minus gy. So this is a metric. So that part is trivial, right? We have already seen that. It is a metric. The questions we want to address are, is it complete? And does it give the same topology on 01? That means the convergent sequences are same. Well, that is easy to see. But before we go to the proof, let's see the motivation. Why do we need 1 by x and 1 by 1 minus x? So if you look at 01, what stops from it being complete with respect to the usual modulus metric? Well, there is a sequence going to 0. And it doesn't converge. There's a sequence going to 1 that doesn't converge inside your space, right? So you want to get rid of those sequences. I don't want those sequences to be Cauchy. For example, 1 by n. 1 by n I know is Cauchy with respect to the usual modulus function, right? But I don't want it to be Cauchy with respect to the new metric, because if it is Cauchy, it doesn't have a, I know that it will converge to, because in the usual topology, I know it converges to zero, right? So I don't want that to happen. So if a sequence goes to zero, I don't want it to be Cauchy. So it should blow up. The distance between the points should blow up. So what do? You look at 1 by x, right? Because 1 by x is a function which goes to infinity as x goes to zero, right? Similarly, 1 by 1 minus x is a function which goes to infinity as x goes to 1. So if I put in those terms, 1 by x minus 1 by y and 1 by 1 minus x minus 1 by 1 minus y, then the sequences going to 0 and 1 will not be Cauchy with respect to the new metric D. So that is the idea, right? So I don't want sequences going to the boundary points in the usual metric to be Cauchy in the new metric. That is the only idea there. So we use that. Okay, so now let us go to the proof. So I have defined this metric D of xy to be equal to mod x minus y plus those two terms, and I know it is a metric. So I want to prove two things. One is it is complete. Second is it gives the same topology on 0, 1. That means same set of convergent sequences inside 0, 1. Okay, so there is no point, there is no sequence going to zero. We are not bothered about such sequences. We are bothered about only sequences happening, converging inside 0, 1. Okay, so D is a metric, that part we already know. Suppose Xn is a Cauchy sequence with respect to D. That means D of Xn Xm is less than epsilon for large n and m, right? Whatever epsilon you take. Since modulus of Xn minus Xm is less than or equal to dxn xm, right? Because mod xn minus xm plus some positive things, that is my d. So d of xn xm is less than epsilon will imply modulus of xn minus xm less than epsilon, and so that will be Cauchy with respect to the usual modulus. But it is a sequence in the real line, right? And it is Cauchy with respect to the modulus. Real line with modulus is complete. So it has to converge to something in X in the real line. So Xn will converge to X in the real line, but with respect to the modulus function. So modulus of Xn minus X will have to go to zero. And from real analysis, you know that the point X will have to be in the closure of open interval 0, 1, which is closed interval 0, 1. Right? So X will be in the closed interval 0, 1. But now you see that the limit point x cannot be 0 or 1, because if it is 0, I have a sequence xn going to 0 in the usual modulus, and so it cannot be Cauchy in the new metric because of the terms 1 by x and 1 by 1 minus x, right? So the xn's, the sequence from open interval 0, 1 cannot converge to x which is 0 or 1. So it cannot converge to 0 or 1 in the usual modulus. It can converge only to some point in the interior of 0, 1, right? Inside 0, 1. But once it converges to a point inside 0, 1, it is easy to see that d of x and x also will go to 0. Well, why is that? If xn converges to x, I know that 1 by xn will converge to 1 by x, right? Because 1 by x is a continuous function and x is not 0. Similarly, I know 1 by 1 minus xn will converge to 1 by 1 minus x because x is not 1. So, and 1 by 1 minus x is continuous. So, in the definition of the metric D, there are three terms. The first term is xn minus x. I know that goes to 0. Second term is 1 by xn minus 1 by x. I know that goes to 0. Third term is 1 by 1 minus xn minus 1 by 1 minus x. That also goes to 0. So when I sum up, I'll get d xn x equal to sum of these three terms. All the terms go to 0. So d xn x goes to 0. Which means xn converges to x in the new metric D. So what did we prove? We proved that if I take a Cauchy sequence xn, Cauchy with respect to the new metric D, I know that it has a limit in the new, in the old metric modulus of xn minus x going to 0, and that particular x is the limit with respect to the new metric as well. Okay, so that is what we proved, and so 01 comma D is complete. So what we did was we changed the metric very cleverly. Very cleverly meaning we made sure that the sequences going to the boundary is not Cauchy, right? By appropriately adding various things, the 1 by x and the 1 by 1 minus. And so converge, and the fact that 1 by x and 1 by 1 minus x are continuous functions helped us in proving that the convergence takes place inside, and in the new metric as well, the convergence takes place. Okay, so that also proves that the convergence sequences are same. So 01 with respect to D is complete, and let's just make sure that we understand that convergence sequences are also same. We check that the convergence sequences are same. Well, you take xn and x inside 01. Suppose dxn x goes to 0, that means xn converges to x in the new metric D. Then, well, I already know mod xn minus x is less than to dxn x, so that will go to 0. So that means xn converges to x in the old metric modulus. Conversely, if xn goes to x in the old metric modulus, then we just proved that dxn x goes to 0, right? Because dxn x is the sum of three terms. Each term goes to 0 because of the continuity of 1 by x and 1 by 1 minus x. And so the sum goes to 0, right? So the upshot of all this is that the space open interval 0, 1 with the metric D is complete, and the space 0, 1 with respect to the metric D and space 0, 1 with respect to the old metric modulus have same convergence sequences. In other words, inside 0, 1, the closed sets are same, and so inside 0, 1, the open sets are same, so the topology are same. So these two metric spaces have the same topology. One of them is complete, other is not. Okay, so what we have done is remetrize the open interval 0, 1 so that the topology doesn't change, but it became complete. Okay. So this is the idea. So this we have done for the open interval 0, 1. Okay. So for people who know topology, this can be done in a much easier way, because you know 0, 1 and the real line are homeomorphic. So you just use the homeomorphism to pull back the metric. Okay. So that will do. But that will not work if I take 0, 1 union, let us say 2, 3. Or open set 2, 3, right? Because it is not connected, so they are not homeomorphic to each other. So you can't do that, but you can do this. You know, you look at the boundary points and you can do exactly what we have done for 0, 1 to prove that 0, 1 union 2, 3 is a complete metric space without changing the topology. But we are going to now, so this is, you know, this is Alexandrov's theorem in the very special case of open interval 0, 1. Okay, so this I hope essentially everybody has understood. I'm going to sort of, in the next, you know, one or two slides, I'll describe Alexandrov's theorem in generality. So we're going to jump in, so without going too much into the proofs. Okay, so I'll leave out all the technicalities. But let's see the general theorem. Okay, so Alexandrov's theorem. So we'll start with open sets. That is not the general theorem. So X T V a complete metric space. O is an open set. Now I can define a metric on O. So I'm going to remetrize O, the open set, without changing the topology of O, but make it complete. Okay. Well, how will you do that? We do exactly what we did with the open interval 0, 1. So you define a new metric D1 x comma y to be dxy plus. So remember, we started with mod x minus y plus something. So the mod x minus y was the original metric on the given space. So here D is the original metric on O. So we don't lose that dxy plus modulus of something. So that something is what I'm going to write down. So that is 1 by distance between x and O complement. Okay, so you look at the distance between x and the set O complement. So I've defined what it is. So if I have a set A in a metric space, I can define the distance between x, a point x, and the set A. Well, that is the natural definition. What do? You look at the distance between x and all points in A and take the infimum, right? That is the closest point to x in A. That is the that's how you define the distance. So where dx o complement equal to infimum over y no complement dxy, right? So you run y over all the points in O complement and look at the distance from x to those points. Take the infimum of this collection. So dxy is positive. So this is a collection of positive numbers. You simply take the infimum that exists, right? And use that as a function. So you define f of x to be d 1 by dx O complement. Okay, that is your function. And then d1xy is dxy plus modulus of fx minus fy. Right, and you know it is a metric, so we have already seen that it's a metric. So in the previous case of open interval 0 1, we had two terms. Okay, we could have avoided that by using this. Okay, but I wanted to sort of stress on the point that we are trying to avoid sequences going to the boundary to be Cauchy, and that is what we are doing here, right? The function 1 by dx O complement will make sure that the sequences going to O complement, that means boundary of O, are not Cauchy, because the distance between sequences going, so if I take a boundary point and if I have a sequence xn converging to the boundary point, then the distance between this sequence and the O complement will reduce. It will become zero, right? It will converge to zero. So 1 by that will blow up. It will go to infinity. That's precisely what we did, right? So remember the example case, open interval 0 1, the function 1 by x is simply 1 by distance from x to 0, and that is what we are using here as well, right? So by taking the function 1 by dx O complement, we make sure that the sequences going to the boundary are not Cauchy in the new matrix. Now it's a basic exercise in metric spaces to prove that the function dx O complement is actually a continuous function. It's actually a uniformly continuous function. And whatever argument we had for the open interval 0 1 works exactly in the same way here as well, right? Because you want to prove that OD1 is complete. Well, how will you do that? You take a Cauchy sequence xn. Now I know that d1 xn xm will go to 0, but dxn xm is less than or equal to d1 of xn xm, right? That was the first step in the case of open interval 0 1. The same step works here, and so it is Cauchy with respect to the old metric D, but old metric D is complete with the whole space X, so it will converge to something in X. Okay, we want to show that that point is inside O, just like what we did earlier, because that point cannot be on the boundary, because if it is in the boundary, then I have a sequence going to the boundary and it cannot be Cauchy with respect to the new metric D1. Okay, it may be Cauchy with respect to the old metric, but it is not Cauchy with respect to the new metric. So the point has to be inside O, just like how we concluded that the limit is inside 0 1, same argument. And then you prove that the topology does not change. That means the convergence sequences are same, exactly like what you did for 0, 1, right? You take a sequence xn converging to x with respect to the old metric D. X is inside 0, inside O. So dxn O complement will have to converge to dx O complement, because that function is continuous. In the earlier case, you had 1 by x and 1 by 1 minus x. Those are continuous function. Similarly, this is the continuous function, so convergence takes place. Okay, so everything works verbatim. Okay, the extra information you need is that the function we have used, dx O complement, is a continuous function. You don't need anything else. Now you go to one more step. So we started with an open set in a metric space. You can actually go to what is known as a G delta set, and that is Alexandrov's theorem. Okay. So this will be very brief. I am not going to get into the proof too much, but I'll try to explain it in words. So take a G delta set. So what is a G delta set? It's the countable intersection of open sets. So I write A as intersection n equal to 1 to infinity ON. Okay, ONs are open. Now the previous slide tells you that on each ON, ON is an open set, I can define a metric rho n. So I denote it by rho n so that ON rho n is complete. Right? We did that. For each any open set, you can do this. So for each ON we define, but the metric may differ, right? As you change, and so the metric on O1 need not be the metric on O2 and O3 and so on. So we denote it by rho n. Now using this rho n, we define a new metric D1 on A by D1 of XY equal to summation n equal to 1 to infinity 1 by 2 to the n rho n of X comma Y by 1 plus rho n XY. Sorry. So let me describe this a little bit. So each rho n is a metric on ON. Now, if you remember the examples, if I have a metric D, then D by 1 plus D is a metric. So rho n by 1 plus rho n is a metric. And I can multiply this with any positive number alpha, right? So 1 by 2 to the n into rho n by 1 plus rho n, that is also a metric. And I add up. So when I add metric, I'll get another metric. Okay. So D1 XY is a metric. So that is a very easy part. The challenge is to prove that it is complete. And more importantly, the convergence sequences are the same. That means the topology are same. Okay. So let us, I'll take I have 2-3 minutes. So I'll just take 1 or 2 minutes to sort of explain what this is. So how will you prove that it is complete? Well, you take a Cauchy sequence in D1, right? You want to prove D1 is complete. So let's take a Cauchy sequence, Xk. Xk is Cauchy with respect to D1. Now, look at the definition of D1. It is sum of positive things, right? So each term in the summation is less than or equal to D1. So I take one of them. So 1 by 2 to the n, rho n by 1 plus rho n. That will be less than or equal to D1, right? But my sequence Xk is Cauchy with respect to D1. So it will be Cauchy with respect to 1 by 2 to the n, rho n by 1 plus rho n. But remember, rho n by 1 plus rho n and rho n are same, right? They are equivalent. Cauchy sequence, the sequences are same. So it will be Cauchy with respect to rho n itself. Okay, so that is the first step. Any Cauchy sequence with respect to D1 is Cauchy with respect to rho n for every n. But each rho n is complete. So it has to converge to something in ON. Okay. But you don't know if the limits are same, right? So in ON, it will converge to some point. In O1, it will converge to some point. In O2, it will converge to some other point. In O3, it may converge to some other point. We don't know. But remember, the rho n's are not some arbitrary complete metric. Right, they give you the same topology. Sorry. So that gives you the same topology, meaning they give you the same convergence sequence with respect to the metric D on X you started with. So if my Cauchy sequence XK converges to X with respect to the metric rho n, it will have to converge with respect to the old metric D as well. Correct? That is how we did everything, right? We didn't want to change the topology. So dxk x goes to 0. That means xk converges to x in D. That means in each rho n, it has to converge to the same point. It cannot change because everything happens with respect to D as well. And with respect to D, the limit has to be unique. So in each ON, the convergence is happening to the same point. Now, if that happens, then you prove that with respect to D1 also, it will converge. Okay, that is easy because it is given by the summation. So if I have a sequence Xk converging to X with respect to all the rho n's, then I know all the rho n's, rho n x k x by 1 plus rho n x k x will go to 0 as k goes to infinity, and when I sum up, it will still go to 0. Okay, so that is an easy part. So it will be complete. Okay, and then you prove that it has the same convergence. That part is essentially the same. Okay, so convergence is same because we just proved. So in 0-1 also you saw that that is how it is. Okay, so Aleksandrov's theorem is this: if I have a complete metric space, then any G delta set can be remetrized without changing the topology to a complete metric space, and that is precisely this method. So I'll take just one moment to say how one, you know, it's not as if you come up with this metric just like that. There is a principle behind it. What you do is you look at ON. ON has a metric rho n. So this is for people who understand topology and things like that. Don't worry too much about it if you don't know what it is. ON with respect to rho n is complete. You look at the infinite product of ON. So there is something called the product topology. The product topology is given by this metric, 1 by 2 to the n rho n by 1 plus rho n. Okay. And that is the metric you put. And the if I have countably many complete metric spaces, I can look at the countable product of that and put a metric on that, which will give me the product topology and make the space complete at the same time. That is what we have done. So what we have done is product of rho ons with the product topology using the matrix rho n is a complete metric space, and the set A sits inside the product on as a diagonal. So that means if I take a point small a in capital A, you look at it as a dot a comma a comma a comma a etc. as the infinite tuple sitting inside product A. Okay, so that is same as A, and you restrict the metric on product an to this diagonal A, and that is this metric. Okay, so that is how you come up with this. But you know, I didn't want to go into product topology and things like that, but this is for people who sort of understand that. Okay, so that is all I wanted to say. Well, the converse of this is also true. That means if I can remetrize a set A into a complete metric space, then A is a G delta set. Okay, so that is called the Mazurkiewicz theorem, but that is a bit more technical than this, so I wouldn't go. Yeah, so that is all I wanted to say. Thank you.